se divide mi altro non lo fa.
Okay, go for it.
Is it running?
Yep.
All right, good afternoon. This is a talk that I came up with a few months ago, I think, and that I just finished recently. It's going to be from our perspective, which we... let me start with the first slide, that might be the best. This is about me. My name is Thomas Craig. I'm actually Danish, so that's why the funny last name. So, in Danish it's actually pronounced Kau, but I'm not going to ask you to try and do that. I work at Wacom. It's a big company you might have heard about. It's in the north of Holland, in Zwolle. And we've been working on a new infrastructure for the last two and a half years or so. And we first started by going live in Belgium with our new code name called Blaze. And we'll first start by talking a little bit about what we do. When I tell people about Blaze, it usually just ends up sounding like a bunch of buzzwords. Because we are actually working with really modern things which you hear a lot about, but you don't really see anyone doing anything with it. It's probably not super readable, but I'll mention a couple of things we do. We do all our configuration management with Ansible. All our backend stuff and all our API stuff is built in Scala or Java. Frontend is in Node.js and Angular. We use Consul, we use Mesos Marathon and Docker for all our production loads. So all our services are running in that. It's built as a microservice infrastructure. And that's the whole architecture behind it. It's all hosted in AWS. We do have data centers locally, but we've decided to go with AWS because of how fast we can build things and the features we have or they have fit very well with what it is that we're trying to do. But essentially, the whole concept behind Blaze is that we should be able to plug it in anywhere. So if we want to use Google tomorrow, we should be able to quickly do that as well. Ansible is used for infrastructure stuff. So that is basically building and deploying machines, and everything that is supposed to run those machines, we want to be able to do with Ansible. We do a little bit of CloudFormation just for the really basic stuff. That's for building our VPCs. VPC in AWS, if you're not aware, is just a virtual private cloud. And other than that, all our deployments of infrastructure software is also done with Ansible. That being said, everything that we do with everything that's related to the website, so to say, that's all being done with Jenkins. So a developer just pushes his latest changes to GitHub. It goes for a pull request review. Then it gets merged into master. Jenkins then picks up the changes, builds a container from it, and pushes it through a bunch of tests. And then if everything is successful, deploys it to first development and acceptance. Then people have a chance to look at it. It does some more tests. And after that, you can decide to push it to production. So, since we have all these lovely microservices, which we use for all our website stuff, we wanted to start using Docker as well for all our infrastructure components, such as Consul, DNS Mask, Fluentd, Prometheus, and so on. And that started up pretty well, but it ended up in Ansible looking like, okay, you have to put in this long of a Docker command to start something up. And there's not really a pretty way of doing it, so you have to do it just with the command module. So you just send raw text through in order to start up a Docker container. And that wasn't exactly pretty. So with CoreOS, what they recommend and how they do it is through using systemd. Does anyone know what systemd is?
Yeah, it's much.
Is there anyone who really hates systemd? That's what I hear a lot as well. I don't really have any, you know, any money in it, so I don't really care if you're using AnyD or Systemd. Systemd works well for us because of how simple your unit files are. You basically, instead of having a huge unit file which you use for AnyD, which usually is several pages long, you just have like, yeah, you can easily put a full Systemd unit file on one screen. So it makes it easier for templating, it makes it easier for basically just writing them. So we started out by writing them. You know, we have a service, okay, we should make a file for that. We did that one or two times and decided, okay, this is extremely boring, so why not automate it? So that's what we did. With Jinja 2. Has anyone used Jinja 2 before?
Yeah.
Yes.
Cool. Jinja 2 is quite powerful. It's not extremely pretty, but it gets the job done. So it has the basic functionality you need. You can do if-else statements, you can do a for loop and stuff like that. And that's pretty much everything you need in order to build a file like this. So we figured, okay, Ansible again to the rescue. Perfect. So this is what it looks like. This is the first part of the file. Oh wait, I think it's in the wrong order. This is the first part of the file. I'm not sure if it's very readable.
No.
Crap. Maybe I can make it a little bit bigger.
Yeah.
Slowly.
1 pixel at a time.
Okay. I have a different idea. Let me show you. It's here instead. With a slightly bigger text. All right.
That's literally even bigger.
That will happen. So first I want to show you a somewhat advanced example of what we do. Let's see. This is what it looks like, and then even bigger.
Is that readable?
Yeah. Okay, good. That took a little bit longer than expected, but hey, we got there in the end. So, for anyone who's seen Systemd before, does it look familiar, except for all the funny stuff? Basically what it does, I'm going to go through it for you slowly, is it will always require a Docker service to start, to be started, of course, else you won't be able to start a container. Other than that, there's an if statement for requirements. So if there is some kind of other requirements, you can put them in a list of variables. I'll show you that in a bit in the playbook. Same thing for before. Same thing for after. Of course, Docker service needs to be started, so it's also a requirement there. Then you have binds to, if that's required. You have once, if that's required. Some default stuff. Then you have the basically your pre-starts. So that will be first, because if you're now deploying a service, you want to first get the old one away to make sure you don't have conflicts. So you basically would always kill it, you always remove it, and you always pull it. By pulling, you would just check if there's a difference between the one I'm running currently and the one that's on Docker Hub currently. So you're not going to have to download everything every time you restart. Here is then the actual start part. There are a few very specific things for us, which is of course team names, so we can see, okay, who's actually responsible for this. Normally it would just be one team, which is our team. That's then also the default, Team Purple. It also defines what kind of container type we have, and then you have a for loop, basically going through all the Docker options you might have. Just to know, does everyone know a little bit about Docker? Just the basics? Okay. So it basically loops through this, checks through all the items you might have in your template, so all the variables you have, and paste them in there. And continues adding options, stuff like that, basically everything you would need. So this might be, I don't know, on a scale of 1 to 10 how complicated this template is. In principle, it's not that super hard to write. And it's a little bit tricky to read because it's all really long one-liners, and it's, yeah, that could be improved somehow probably. But we'll see in the future. So, let's try and go back to the slides. More readable. That's good. So that was basically what I was showing you as well. Alright. Now for an example role. Is this readable?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank God. So what it does is it includes this this templating thing you just saw before, which just has a very simple main YAML. I'll show you that as well before going further. It has the variables you see, which is just some shell scripts which it takes here. It has some requirements, which is it needs to start after console, it needs to start after Fluentd. Fluentd is essentially like Logstash, but better in my opinion. You put in your name, and your image name will come from a variables file that you have specified already. Of course, this is all variables. There's nothing else than just variables you put in. It has Docker options from here, which is what ports you need to publish. So basically, use your inventory host name and ask what port bindings you want available. What network it should use. So you have a bridge network or you have a host network, for example, you could use. What volumes it needs to attach. And then environment variables that it needs to add as well. Log drivers and log options. That's about it. And with that, you can do something like this.
Thomas, that code that you showed, is that somewhere online? Open sourced or proprietary?
It's not open sourced yet. It is available. We are thinking of putting it in on Galaxy as well.
Yes.
Okay,
then it's open source.
Yeah, but you guys can already use it because it's just in my presentation and that's publicly available. That's one way to work around it. So I made a very, very simple, test. what my plan is to just do, I have a vagrant host running. I'll just destroy it so you know I'm not cheating. And I'll set it up again. On there, it's just a CentOS 7 point something running with Docker on it. And other than that, there should be nothing else running. So what I want to do is just using this playbook and this role, make a systemd file for Nginx, and then make sure it runs. So it should be available. So.
There's one VM inside the paper? Or?
There's just one VM, yeah. So it's going to be a very super simple thing. It's not going to be complicated at all. This is what I had time for in 2 hours. So this is what it contains. So it's just a vagrant file for vagrant itself, of course. I just added some configuration stuff for Ansible. Yeah, the vagrant host is then in the hosts. You have then the playbook, which I'm going to run, and then two roles, which is then the Docker systemd, which is the which has the main task, which uses the template to build the systemd file with, and the Nginx role, which is what you would where you would put all your variables in, so you could use that to build with. But I'll show you all the files as well. So first, just so you can see that there's nothing weird, it is just a CentOS 7 and Docker VM box, which is being downloaded. William Yeh built those, which is very good boxes. And I just forward one port. So it's exposing 8080 locally for me. The playbook is extremely simple as well. It just points out, okay, it needs to go to the Docker host, it needs to be root, doesn't need to get a fax, doesn't matter, and just use the Nginx role. So if you now look at the roles, we have two different ones. We'll start with Nginx, which is then just, you want to create a systemd file for Nginx. You want to include your systemd main task, and these are just a few variables you want to add with it. And then a tag is optional, of course. If there's anyone that has questions during this, just feel free to stop me or yell at me or throw something at me. Everything's fine. The other part is then the Docker systemd. I'll start with just showing the task, which is also very simple. It makes the file. Let's see if I can make it even bigger for you guys. Is it more readable?
Yeah.
More readable? All right. So it starts out by creating the systemd file using the template module, using the template that you just saw, which I'll show again in a second. Where it should put it, what rights it should have on it. It needs to restart the daemon, pull down the container for the first time, and start it for the first time. And if you need to, restart it. Then the second part, which is of course the most super interesting part, is the template. Well, I just showed you that so you know pretty much how it works. You now saw the variables that I put in. So you know pretty much what you should expect to see once it's up and running. So, we should have good Wi-Fi here. So let's just take it off from the start. All right, so I do wake it up just to get the machine back up and running from a brand new state. See, it's just doing the forwarding for SSH and for the forwarding I needed in order to get Nginx to show. let's just start by looking at the machine itself. It's reachable. What do we have currently? Well, pretty much nothing. You can see Docker is installed. That's pretty much all I care about. But there's no Nginx currently, so okay. I really want Nginx on this machine. Because Nginx is awesome. So it's just a matter of, running the playbook. Pulls the container from the Docker Hub itself. You can of course specify if you have your own Docker host running locally. Starts up the service. That was it. So if I can now just get a Chrome window open. And I would go to we have the welcome page of Nginx. So how does that look on the machine? So if you're on here, we now go loop again. You can see Nginx is here now. It's not completely readable, but at least it lives right here. See that it has all the starting variables that we included as well. It's now all done for us. So just through adding these variables and having this systemd template in place, you can really quickly put up whatever service it is you want to use. As long as it's in a container. Essentially you just need to specify what container you want to have, what version, and whatever extra stuff you want to add to it. So the file itself is looking like this now. That's not installed. So you can see it has the description, Nginx container, which is just name container, which is taken from the template. It only requires a Docker service to start. So after the Docker service is started, you're allowed to start the Nginx container. It should always restart. This is basically default stuff from systemd. If you're doing a restart of the service, it should first kill it, remove it, and then pull it again. And you can see I've specified in the end that it's Nginx and it's the stable Alpine version. Alpine is just a very small Docker image, which is like 20 megabytes. So very handy. And then the start things you needed. This basically just takes all your variables and puts them on one line with a line break escape. And you have the same kind of stuff. And with that, essentially you could say, okay, if I need a database as well, my database would require Nginx to be running, so you would have requirements already set in there. I mean, the possibilities are endless, kind of. So what we use it for is essentially everything that's running, which is not packaged and sent to our Marathon host, essentially. That was pretty much it. I'm not sure how high above level or below level this was, but it was something I wanted to try and share, because I found it was an interesting approach to easily building files. You could use it for any configuration file you want to build as well. You can build them the same way. So are there any questions? Please.
Quite straightforward.
Well, it's just a funny implementation of Ansible to solve another problem we have. But the next thing,
Are you using Ansible to schedule containers?
No. There we use, we have a Mises cluster running,
okay.
And then the scheduler with Marathon and Talka. So that's what our web infrastructure actually is running on. So this is all our infrastructure combined components. So there will be DNS mask and logging and all those kind of small things that you need just to have a host running properly. It could be, if I'm not completely blacklisted, I can log into the server and show you how it looks. So we have some mass nodes running. Those are usually quite, no, they're all soft except for this. But we have IP restrictions only, so that's all gone. So if you look here, what we have running. Oh, actually, it's probably just easier to show you.
Did you SSH into a Docker microservice?
No, what I SSH to now is. A Mesos slave, that's basically where all our Docker containers live. So not just Docker containers we use for internal use, so to say, but actual, their website is hosted on here. Mm-hmm. But this is acceptance, so I can't break too much. So you can see we have a bunch of stuff running, DNS mask being one of them. We have a garbage collector for Docker, Docker registry, Fluentd, Mesos slave itself runs as a service in Docker. We have Prometheus, three different kinds of exporters. We have a proxy service and a registrar service. So if you look at one of the, that will be complicated. Probably one of our Prometheus things. But it's also not too bad. Don't we have something more impressive? It's all pretty straightforward, right? I mean, you have some very simple consistency in all your system defaults this way. And it gets all the information you have from setting variables in different places. The next step we probably want to do is, instead of just using Ansible for templating, we want to try and use Consul Template as well. Because we have a lot of variables there already, and there might be some things that have to change on the fly. And their console template could then take over those parts. Please shoot more questions.
Do you only provision the Docker part with Ansible, or because you're also using Mesos, and there are also a lot of Mesos modules for Ansible? Is that also something you're having implemented, or are you still in the planning to implement that?
For Mesos and Marathon, all we use Mesos and Marathon for now is everything that's website specific.
Okay.
So everything that's not running on a website, but we still need a service like this, we build these system defaults.
Okay.
In the future, we do want to make, for example, we have an engineering omgeving, and on there you want to have a lot of different tools running, and also console and everything else you want to have running on there, but it actually makes more sense to then actually just have a Mesos and Marathon cluster for that as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something we're going to do in the future. So we're going to put Jenkins on there and everything else that's really needed as a backbone for our engineers to deploy software.
And you want that provisioning to be done also through Ansible?
That provisioning will then be done probably through Ansible. If you have any generic questions about other things we do, that's also fine. Else, it seems like it was a super simple thing, and everyone can now go home and Dockerize everything they do. Right? All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you.